Margarita and Citroni. She's going to talk about chemistry at high pressure.
Hi. So here is a not very new but still valid diagram where is shown all the pressure temperature range that is available for experiments using static pressure. And here is the estimated pressure temperature profile for the Earth. If we bring our everyday molecules to these extreme pressure and temperatures, most of them will react. So we have a huge chemistry laboratory where are available many new reaction routes that are still unpredictable. So in order to exploit this laboratory, we have to understand the reaction mechanisms and make these reactions predictable. This is not a very easy task because there are many complicated interactions in the solids, so it's difficult to predict them theoretically, and it's also difficult in experiments to separate the many variables that are present, like pressure, temperature, the crystal structure, and the molecular structure. So understand chemistry in solid state is mostly understand how the pressure-induced changes to the electronic structure affect the molecules so much that they will reversibly or irreversibly change their chemical bonding scheme. So some very famous examples are carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide among the four group elements is the only one whose carbon is the only element of the four group whose dioxide is stable as a single molecule, and the single molecule is stable up to 40 GPa. But if we laser heat the phase 3 of CO2, we obtain a non-molecular phase where carbon is linked to four oxygen atoms, like in quartz. So the bonding scheme is completely changed. And following a different path in the phase diagram, we obtain an amorphous phase, which is similar to amorphous silica, and is called carbonia. And this example shows is like a very important example because it shows how pressure can deeply change the chemistry of the elements so that carbon becomes similar to silicon or to germanium. Red oxygen is another important example because it has a phase, the epsilon phase, that is stable in a very large pressure temperature range, where oxygen is present as 0.8 units, where the oxygen molecules are linked by weak covalent bonds. Another important example is nitrogen. Nitrogen is a very interesting example because the triple bond between nitrogen atoms is much more stable than any other bond scheme between nitrogen atoms. So if we synthesize a solid containing many nitrogen atoms bonded by single or double bonds, it is called polynitrogen. This is a very high energy density material because it will decompose, giving back nitrogen molecules, releasing a lot of energy. So a lot of research is done to synthesize these kind of materials. And actually, in this part of the phase diagram, it has been found that nitrogen is stable as a crystal, where a covalent crystal, where all nitrogen atoms are linked by single bonds. So in order to speak about chemical reactions, is useful to speak in terms of potential energy surfaces. So I will very briefly define what is a potential energy surface. In a molecular system, in the Born-Oppenheimer approximation, we separate the electronic and the nuclear motion. And if we resolve the electronic Hamiltonian for many different nuclear configurations, we obtain a series of energy levels. And these energies, electronic plus potential energy due to the nuclear configuration, for many nuclear configurations, we obtain an energy profile for the ground state and for the all the excited states, that for the atomic molecule is simply along one coordinate. For an n-atomic molecule, it is a surface with 3n minus 6 independent coordinates. If we talk about a reacting system, we have to use not only the 3n minus 6 variables, of course, but also the 3n minus 6 variables for each molecule in the system and all the intermolecular variables. So it is a very a huge amount of independent variables. So the reaction coordinate is any path that connects a product a reactant to a product. The intrinsic reaction coordinate is the minimum energy coordinate that connects the reactant to the product. And the transition state is the point of maximum energy on this intrinsic reaction coordinate. With chemistry, we will deal mostly with molecular solids, which are characterized by the covalent bonds and by the van der Waals intermolecular interactions that are 100 times weaker than the intermolecular bonds, intramolecular bonds, sorry. So pressure will, in a first instance, affect the intermolecular interaction, and then it will affect the chemical bonds. So we have seen, for instance, in nitrogen and in carbon dioxide that from a molecular crystal we obtained a covalent crystal. So the intermolecular potential, we can imagine this having its vibrational levels that in a solid, in a crystal is represented by the lattice phonons. And there are different effects occurring from heating or from increasing the pressure. By heating, we populate higher vibrational levels in lattice phonons. So by the anharmonicity, we increase the probability to find the system in longer intermolecular distances. So we have a thermal expansion. By increasing the pressure, as opposite, we give mechanical work and we squeeze the system going to explore this region where the potential is repulsive. This is a very famous diagram where nitrogen, it's represented the volume of nitrogen as a function of temperature along many different, as a function of temperature, sorry, along different isobars. And we see that just by compressing by 10 GPa, which is a relatively low pressure with respect to the pressure that we can find in our planet, we have a volume reduction of 50% of the molar volume. As opposite, by increasing the temperature of a larger amount with respect to the range found in our planet, we only have a reduction of 10%. So by changing pressure, we can explore a much larger region of the energy landscape. So we will find probably new reactions. We will have more possibility of finding new reactions than just by temperature. So increasing temperature, we populate higher vibrational levels by changing the temp. So we will probably overcome some energy barrier. And by changing the pressure, we just go in different parts of the energy landscape. So we will find new possibilities of finding a reaction coordinate. So this is summarized by this diagram that was shown the first in the first lecture by Valentin. By when we decrease the intermolecular distances, we explore this part of the potential energy surface, and we may overcome an energy barrier to another minimum with aid, the aid of temperature that populates the higher vibrational levels. Now, in the following, I will use the reaction coordinate, so I will reverse this graph because our reaction coordinate is a compression coordinate. I forgot to say that we can have reversible or irreversible reactivity with pressure depending if this minimum of the product is higher or lower with respect to the starting system. In the case of carbon dioxide and of nitrogen, we found with covalent solids, a minimum that it's when we go back to room pressure, is at higher energy with respect to the molecules. So the product will go back to the reactant. But in many cases that I will describe later, this minimum is at a lower energy. So we can obtain a product that will be recovered at room conditions. So now we will show real examples where pressure and temperature drive reactivity. Our experimental setup is simply the diamond anvil, the membrane diamond anvil cell, because we will explore relatively low pressures and temperatures with sample dimension typically of 100 micron diameter and 50 micron thickness. And we will use mostly spectroscopic and diffraction techniques. Vibrational spectroscopy is the most sensitive tool to detect any modification in the chemical bonding scheme, and is also fundamental to identify the reaction product in detail because it gives a real fingerprint of the product. Electronic spectroscopy as a function of pressure is important to study the modification of the electronic structure that will finally bring to reactivity. X-ray diffraction is very important because it gives us information on the crystal structure from which the reactivity occurs, and of course the molecules are like fixed to some relative positions and orientation that will be important to decide which product we will obtain. And then I must mention that there are advancements in the applying all these techniques to time-resolved measurements. It's too early to have results from this on reactivity, but this will allow to photograph separately the steps of the reactions. The first example I will show is benzene, that is the prototype of aromatic molecule. If we compress benzene at room temperature, we will enter phase one, then a phase two, and then we will find at this point 40 GPa at room temperature, the first signs of a chemical reaction. And these signs of a chemical reaction, we'll start to see them at all these points. If we compress along these different isotherms, we will see that the reaction starts at a lower pressure if we have a higher temperature. The onset of the reaction is can be detected by the change in the infrared spectrum. Here we see a blue shift of the bands with increasing pressure, but this is not due to a reaction. This is just due to the fact that the molecules, when you increase pressure, even if the intermolecular bonds are mostly affected, even the intramolecular bonds are a little bit affected because the molecules become more rigid, so they will vibrate at a higher frequency. So the blue shift is a normal thing that happens by compression. But what is not usual is that we see a change in the background, that if we make the different spectrum, we see in this case that it's a stretching band of saturated carbon. This means that the benzene molecule has broken and some saturated bonds have formed. This product in the end is called amorphous hydrogenated carbon and is an extended solid, completely disordered. So the molecules have completely broken and there is this network of containing many kinds of bonds between carbon and hydrogen. And another particular thing is that the reaction is, here is the pressure increasing. We see that at some pressure we have the first sign of the reaction given by the appearance of saturated carbon. But then it just increases a little bit by increasing the pressure. But when I release the pressure, the reaction explodes. So just by increasing here, I give the input for the reaction to start, but then the real explosion of the reaction occurs on the compression. So the nice thing is that this stability line that I detected by infrared spectroscopy is a straight line. And the higher is the temperature, the lower is the pressure required. So at the microscopic level, what does it happen? Why there is this stability line with this shape? By X-ray diffraction, we could determine all the distances between nearest neighbors molecules along this crystallographic axis, the A, B axis, and the diagonal, at all these points. So these nearest neighbor distances are too large to allow reactivity. But then we must take into account that the molecules are vibrating all the time, so there is some instant in which they are closer, because they are, especially translations, will bring them closer for some at some times. So if we calculate the contribution of this thermal motion that is calculated by this classical formula, and we add this correction in the moment of maximum in which the moment at which they are maximally close to each other, we see that at all these points this minimum instantaneous distance is the same, and is actually 2.6 Armstrong is calculated to be a distance where these molecules actually react. So we see that this stability line that we determined macroscopically has really a microscopic meaning. If we make fluorescence measurements, we see that the fluorescence spectrum changes with pressure. This is the typical emission of the benzene monomer, and we see that by increasing pressure, this fluorescence decreases. And there is another fluorescence band that increases a lot with pressure that is due to this dimer. This dimer is due to an excited molecule of benzene, which is bonds to an unexcited molecule. And this is something that is well known at room pressure in the liquids and in solutions. But in the crystal, this is very difficult because the molecules are not in a good position, in a good relative position to make this kind of dimers. Only when I increase the pressure, they can actually go closer and form these dimers. So by fluorescence, we have really the possibility to see when this is formed. And we see that the relative intensity of this band with respect to the monomer increases up to 10 GPa and then is constant, and is like the 100% of the emission. So what does it mean? That it means that when we excite benzene, we form this species. And we also know that if we continuously irradiate benzene at the pressure that is cannot allow any reactivity, actually the sample will photochemically react and will give the same product as the product found in this region. In fact, what we have is that by going to the excited states, you remember this diagram here? Here there is an excited state that is very close to something that I can reach with pressure. I actually obtain a geometry in the excited state that is very similar to a geometry of a transition state that I can obtain by pressure. But in this case, I need a very high pressure to obtain it, while by excitation, I can obtain the same thing at a much lower pressure. And in both cases, I can obtain the decay to a product that is stable at room pressure. A similar example is triazine. Triazine is like benzene, but it has three nitrogen atoms. So it is very interesting for us because it could be the starting material to form a high energy density material containing a single or double bonded nitrogen. And also here we found a stability line that recalls the one of benzene. But then at some point I see that this stability line changes shape and becomes insensitive to temperature. Another interesting thing about triazine is that the characteristics of the product change between this. In this region I obtain a very dark red product and a very hard. In this region I obtain a very pale yellow product and very brittle. These characteristics of the product can be related to the structure. These are hypothetical structures of possible products from triazine. A dark red and hard material means a higher conjugation because of the color, and the hard product means that it has a less amount of terminations. So it will be more similar to this kind of product, while a pale product will mean lower conjugation, and very brittle means that contains many terminating groups and will be more similar to this compound. These are infrared spectra of triazine changing with pressure. And we see that in this case, the reaction is not detected by the formation of saturated carbon as it was in benzene, but is mainly detected by the formation of absorption bands that are due to the formation of this kind of bonds. And the product, this was the product of benzene, and these are the various products obtained in different conditions of reactivity of triazine. And also in this case, they can be assigned to an amorphous compound, an extended solid, completely disordered, containing all these kind of bonds. Similarly to benzene, also here we can explain the stability line by measuring the X-ray diffraction as a function of pressure and measuring the nearest neighbor distances along different directions. And these are the minimum distances that are found along this direction and along this direction. But also in this case, these distances are too long to allow reactivity. So also in this case, we have to take into account the thermal contribution due to the vibrations of the crystal. And also in this case, we find that by adding these corrections, we obtain exactly the same reactive distances that we found in benzene. So this confirms the results of benzene. And also in this case, it gives a microscopical meaning to this stability line. But this doesn't explain what happens here at 8 GPa, because the distance here, for instance, is much larger than the one that the distance that would allow reactivity, and it corresponds to this point. And also at this point, the distances, if we look better, are not so small. We can understand what happens here by looking at what happens to the electronic states. The electronic states of triazine are of n pi star character or of pi star character because the molecular orbitals are of n type, which are the molecular orbitals localized on the nitrogen atoms, and the molecular orbitals the pi orbitals are the molecular orbitals delocalized on the aromatic ring. So the excitations from this orbital will give rise to this state, and the excitations from the pi orbitals will give rise to this higher state. So if we perform absorption spectra, these actually are not exactly absorption spectra, but two-photon excitation spectra, and I will explain after why we are doing this kind of measurement. But we can think about the spectra as if they were absorption spectra. We see that this is the absorption edge of the pi star state. It moves to low energies. It means that this state it's decrease. It's going closer. The excitation energy that I need to observe this transition is decreasing. So it means that this state is getting closer to the ground state. And here I have the estimation of this energy edge. And I see that it decreases up to 8 GPa, and then it stops decreasing. If I measure the fluorescence spectrum instead, I see that the fluorescence spectrum is absolutely doesn't change with pressure. The fluorescence spectrum does not represent the pi pi star state, but the n pi star state, because after excitation, the fluorescence always comes from the lowest vibrational state of the lowest excited state. So this means that with pressure, I decrease the energy gap between these two states, but the energy gap between these two remains constant. So the picture can be this one, where the ground state and the pi pi star state become closer, and the n pi star state is fixed. In terms of the molecular orbitals, this can be translated in this picture, where the aromatic ring orbitals are destabilized by pressure so much that they become very close to the n molecular orbitals. And this will bring to this picture. So this means that the aromatic ring is completely destabilized, and the system will react by effect of pressure independently of the temperature. So this is in perfect accordance to this stability line. I mentioned two photon absorption. This is used because it gives us the possibility to select spatially the sample, because it depends on the second power of the incident energy. So if we focalize a beam on a sample, it will have a signal just from the sample, avoiding the anvils. I can go into details if you want after, but now I will not enter into details. The examples that we have seen, we measured the X-ray diffraction, and we saw that the crystal structure actually allows the reactivity. But there are also some cases where the crystal structure does not allow an interactive approach, and other kinds of bonds are formed, like hydrogen bonds, which stabilize the crystal, and in this case, there is no reactivity. And in fact, for instance, these two systems are very stable with pressure. And this, in this case, we have reactivity only where there are crystal defects. Because in this, in crystal defects, we can relax this structure, and we can have a direct approach of the aromatic electronic distribution, and we can have the reactivity. But the reaction at crystal defects is easily distinguished from the reactivity like in benzene or triazine, because in this case we don't have a stability line, but we have a reactivity that depends a lot on the history of the sample, for the amount of product and also for the pressure at which it occurs. Now I will speak of a different topic, that is the selectivity that we can have in the chemical reactivity in crystals. And it is known as the topochemical principle. It's very intuitive that the minimum energy reaction path from a product to a reactant will be the one that requires the minimum displacement of the reactant at each step. This is because the reorientations of the molecules in a crystal are very expensive in terms of energies. So if we have a very isotropic crystal like benzene, we will have a disordered product, because the molecules don't have a preferential direction where to react. We have seen, for example, in benzene and in triazine that the shortest contacts were along different directions. But in some cases, we have more anisotropic crystals, where there is only one interaction that is favored. And in this case, we can obtain more ordered products like polymers. Ordered polymers, I mean. For instance, in ethylene, is another model system, because it's the most simple system with a double bond. We can observe reactivity by compressing the liquid. We obtain a disordered phase, orientationally disordered phase, and then a crystal phase. And we can observe reactivity at all these points. And it was studied mostly, more accurately, at these two pressure points. The reaction also in this case is studied by infrared spectroscopy, and we see the bands of polyethylene that are growing. Polyethylene can be formed in very different configurations. It can be very ordered and linear, like in this case, and in this case it can have a very high quality packing, so a very good crystal quality and high density, or it can be more branched and disordered, and in that in this case we will have a less dense a low density polyethylene. So because we studied the reaction at these two different pressure, we compare. This is the product recovered from the reaction at 3.6 GPA, and this the one recovered from 5.4 GPA. And these are two commercial polyethylene, high density, like this one, and the low density, more branched and disordered. And there are some infrared bands that are attributed only to the amorphous domain, in particular this band here. And we can see that the polyethylene recovered from this reaction does not contain almost any of this amorphous domain, much less than the commercial best high-quality polyethylene. So in this case, the high-pressure reaction was very selective. In this case, instead, we have a much less selectivity, and we have a lot of amorphous domains, much more than in the low-density commercial polyethylene. So we have the same reaction at very slightly different pressures, and in one case it gave a very ordered polyethylene, and in one case it gave a very disordered one. And we can explain why. Because in the ethylene crystal at room pressure, there is one direction that is favored, because in this direction, the distances here is they are not corrected for thermal motion. So this is a large distance at room pressure, but at 3 GPA, and considering the thermal motion, it has not been studied, but we can imagine that it will be a reactive distance. And also, the angle is very favorable for the formation of a bond here to make a saturated carbon, an sp3 carbon, a link between two sp3 carbons. And this is the only possible reaction path. But it is known from measurement, this structure has never been studied as a function of pressure yet. But it is known by measurements at low temperature that just increasing a little bit the pressure, the compressibility is anisotropic. And the B axis is compressed much more than the other axis. So this axis is compressed much more. So we can imagine that this distance also will become very similar to this one. And so by increasing the pressure, we obtain another possible reaction route that is this one. So we will have probably a branching of the product. That is what we observed here in the amorphous domains. Okay. Very important informations on the reactivity are obtained from the analysis of the reaction rate. The reaction rate is defined as the rate of disappearance of the product or appearance of disappearance of the reactant or appearance of a product. And in our case, the concentration of the product or the reactant is taken as the integrated absorbance of an infrared band that we see decreasing or increasing. The rate constant changes with respect to temperature and to pressure. The dependence of the rate constant on temperature will give us the activation energy, and the dependence of the rate constant on pressure will give us the activation volume. Of course, these quantities are related to the slow step of the reaction. The activation volume is, like by analogy to the activation energy, is the difference between the molar volume of the transition state and the molar volume of the initial system. And it is due to the fact that the molecules to react in the transition state will have to rearrange, maybe, so they will occupy a volume that is larger than the starting volume, or they will not have any need for rearrangement. And in this case, the activation volume will be zero or maybe negative. There is also an environmental contribution to the activation volume that is due to the change in the surrounding system when the molecules react. Actually, in our case, the solvent is the crystal itself, so maybe we can just consider this contribution. Okay, these pictures are referred to reactions where the reaction rate is really represents the breaking or forming of chemical bonds. But actually, in condensed phases, many times the reaction kinetics is dominated by the transport of matter to the reaction site. So it depends by the diffusion coefficient of the species that have to react. In a crystal, the diffusion is just the translational and librational modes, so to the lattice phonons. And this diffusion step is sometimes preceded by a nucleation step, where the reactive sites must be formed. So the first seeds of reaction have to start. So a very common rate law is the Avrami law that describes the growth of a product phase or of a solid phase in another solid phase, including a nucleation step. In this Avrami law, there is a parameter N that takes into account, that gives us information on the dimensionality of the growth. So if N has a low value, the growth is one-dimensional. The higher is N, the more three-dimensional is the growth. So we can apply this to ethylene that we saw before. At 3.6 GPA, where we obtained the very high density and the linear and ordered polymer, these are the kinetic data. These are the absorbance of the polyethylene band that grows with time, and it can be fitted by the Avrami law. And we see that N is 0.4, which means a linear growth. At 5.4 GPA, where we obtain the very low density and branched product, we see that we need two Avrami curves to fit this data. One of them has a very low N parameter, that means a linear growth, and the other one indicates a two-dimensional growth. So it really represents the branching of the product. So these data are, these models really tell us something about the mechanism. About diffusion-controlled reactions, we have to say that in liquids, the viscosity increases with pressure, so the diffusion coefficient decreases. And when we compress a sample, and sometimes we obtain a glass, the reactivity is almost never observed in glassy phases. But in crystals, instead, there are these collective motions that are the lattice phonons. And in this case, as we saw for benzene and triazine, where we could quantitatively measure this contribution, we can again see the reactivity. Here are examples of glassy phases where we didn't observe any reactivity. In butadiene, that I will show in a bit, we observe reactivity in all the phase diagram, but not in this glassy phase. And also in propylene, we observe a reaction in many parts of the phase diagram, but never, even by compressing a lot, in the solid state, that is a disordered phase. So in the glass, we don't have a reactivity, usually. The last example I will show is butadiene, that is a model system for conjugated molecules. And at room pressure, it is a liquid, and it can give many different products. The main ones are a dimer and a polymer that can be branched in any possible way, and it can be cis or trans. In the liquid, I can observe reactivity, and if I compress to 0.7 GPA, I obtain the complete transformation into a dimer. If at the same pressure, if I use photochemical activation, I don't obtain any of this product, but I obtain a very ordered linear polymer that is completely trans and linear. And it's here is compared to a commercial polymer. And we see that even in the best polymer obtained by the normal synthesis, here I have a lot of bands of the cheese product, and here is completely trans in our case. And this is due to the fact that photo excitation makes, in the excited state, a molecule that is much more flexible and it's much more reactive to give the trans polymer. But in the crystal phase, I also observe reactivity. And in this case, I always have a competition between these two reactions. And here, there is a very interesting observation that at low pressure, I just obtain this molecule. And at high pressure, I obtain a mixture of the two. And this is intuitive because at high pressure, I can have a closer approach of molecules that can form this structure. But what is a little bit unusual is that I see, okay, here are the kinetic data in a logarithmic form. This is, okay, the slope of these lines gives us the reaction rate. So the steeper is the line, the faster is the reaction. At very low pressure, the reaction is very fast. At high pressure, at an intermediate pressure around 5 GPa, the reaction rate is very slow. And this means that between in these two pressures, the activation volume is positive. And if we see the crystal structure, this is normal because the two molecules to form the dimer must have a rearrangement that requires an extra volume in the transition state. So the reaction is retarded by pressure. But then if I increase the pressure more than 5 GPa, the reaction rate increases again. And at the same time, I also observe the formation of the polymer. So here I have the logarithm of the reaction rate that decreases with pressure, and then it increases again. And here I have the ratio between the amount of polymer and the amount of dimer. From this graph, we can see that the more polymer is formed, the more the reaction rate is increased. So this can be pictured at the microscopic level with the fact that when the polymer forms, because the molecules along the crystallographic axis that are more compressed favors the polymerization creates some defects in the crystal that make easier these reorientations of the transition state of the dimer. So there is a competition between these two products, but actually the formation of this product also favors the formation of this one. So there is like a positive feedback between the two reactions. And this gives us, makes us easy to define what is the reaction cage, that is the space occupied by the reacting molecules in the starting environment. So in general, we don't want to disturb too much the crystal, so the topochemical principle is the same thing. I don't want to make too much changes in the crystal. But if I create some defects, I can relax this reaction cage. So in the case of butadiene, I have, with the polymerization, I have changed, enlarged the reaction cage, and I gave space to the dimer for the formation of the dimer. So in summary, we have reviewed the pressure and temperature activation of reactivity, a summary of reaction kinetics, topochemical principle, cooperation and competition between reactions in crystals, the difference in reactivity between the glasses and crystals. In crystals, the reaction is reactivity is possible thanks to the thermal motions, or organized thermal motions due to the lattice vibrations, and the role of crystal defects and the definition of the reaction cage.
this afternoon or this evening. But do you want to make any question?
What's the picture?
This one is the product from Triazine.
I have a question. Regarding the Abrams law that you use to describe the kinetics of the reactions, the parameters of the equation are fitting parameters, but they have some physical meaning.
Yes.
For example, you say the n
is the dimensionality, and then
and
there
the
k is the reaction rate.
Is the reaction rate?
Yes. And
see, the exponential part of the equation, and also has to do with something energy.
Well, if we is our measure of the, especially we are interested in the changes of the reaction rate by pressure and temperature. So this, a reaction rate by itself doesn't tell us so much, but it's with respect to different pressure and temperatures. In fact, all these studies must be done, must be performed at many different pressure and temperatures to have a meaning. If I just take one pressure and temperature point, I don't have much information.